Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to Hiya Kadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible is our only standard for truth. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Well, friends, are you feeling blessed in Jesus this morning? I trust you are. Are you reading your Bible every day? Are you keeping up with us and reading 5 chapters every day? I hope that you are. Are you abiding in the Spirit and conforming your life to every word of the Holy Bible? I hope that you are. Well, I am so thankful that you're with us this morning, friends. And I just want to say from my heart, I love you. I appreciate you. And I pray for each of you, the viewers, each and every day. Now, today is November the 14th in the year of our Lord, 2017, and this is One a Day for the Soul. Now, we're continuing our study in the book of Hebrews, and over the last several days, the writer of the book of Hebrews, which I believe to be Paul, but very well could have been Barnabas, and so if I say Paul, you'll have to excuse me, it's just from habit, but the writer of Hebrews has laid a foundation for us on who Jesus is. That he is more than a man, and he deserves all of our allegiance, all of our worship, and all of our adoration. And so he begins in chapter 2, and he says, Therefore, knowing this, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Now that lest at any time indicates that there is going to be consequences if we let them slip. And so let's understand what those consequences are. Verse 2 says, If the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, if we act in disobedience, if we give ourselves unto the things of this world instead of the things of God? There are consequences to those acts of transgression, those acts of disobedience. And this great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, has been confirmed, was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, the prophets, the apostles, the disciples. Verse 4, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. Now, in order for us to understand this warning, let's turn to chapter 10 and let's look at verse 26 through verse 30. It says, If we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries, the enemies of the Lord. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under 2 or 3 witnesses. Of how much sorer punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who has trodden underfoot the Son of God, and has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he has been sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. For we know him that has said, Vengeance belongs unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And why would we fall into the hands of the living God? Back to our text. If the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Well, let's look at chapter 3 and let's look at verse 12. It says, Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Now notice he says, Take heed, brethren. He's talking to brothers and sisters in the Lord here. He's not talking to a man who is living in sinful disobedience to the Lord, but to brethren. And so he says, Take heed, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. How do you depart from the living God? By choosing to live your way, to follow the desires of your heart instead of living God's way and following the desires of his heart, living according to his word. He says in verse 18, to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest? Verse 19, so we see they could not enter because of unbelief or lack of obedience. The warning here is strong, friends, that we are to fight the good fight of faith every day, that we are to beat our bodies into subjection, that we are to submit ourselves unto the Lord Jesus whom we serve, and that we are to be very cautious, alert, and aware of every act of disobedience that tries to slip its way into our lives, so that we can again humble ourselves, ask for forgiveness, strength, and power, so that we don't commit that sin again. He says in chapter 3, verse 6, Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm until the end. But what if we let it slip? What if we transgress? What if we backslide? Back to chapter 10, verse 26. If we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sins, but instead a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation from the hand of God, which shall devour his enemies. And we become an enemy of the Lord when we give ourselves to the things of this world. That's what James chapter 4, verse 4 says. He who is a friend of the world is an enemy of God. And look at verse 31 in chapter 10. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. And so, having seen all these passages working together like a puzzle that has been perfectly fit together, let's again read our text. Therefore, knowing these truths, we ought to give the more earnest heed. That requires work, friends. That requires discipline. That requires turning off the TV and reading the Bible. That requires turning off all that technology has to offer us and praying for those whom we know and those whom we don't know. Praying for politicians, praying for Hollywood, praying for movie actors, praying for music musicians, praying for the governments of the world, praying for our families, our friends, our co-workers, praying for strangers, those that we don't know who are hurting, that go to bed cold every night, go to bed hungry every night, those who are in persecution, and especially those who are suffering for the cause of Jesus. Let us give more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Now, I can speak to you from experience. A lot of times when we let things slip, it's because we've drifted from the things that are important to God and important to our journey as followers of God. When we quit reading our Bibles, when we quit fellowshipping with the Lord, when we quit examining our hearts and our lives. If we're not getting closer to God on a day-by-day basis, then we're getting closer to the world on a day-by-day basis. And that's why Jesus said, you cannot serve God and mammon. You must choose one or the other. Because the things that you pursue and the things you set your mind upon is what you will become. And so if you want to be a better follower of the Lord Jesus, you have to commit to the things that are important to the Lord Jesus. That's why he said, if you love me, you'll obey my commandments. You'll give yourselves to the things that are important to me. You see, in verse 2, these words are so important that they were spoken by angels, and we were told that every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward. You reap what you sow. And so don't deceive yourselves in verse 3. How do you think you're going to escape the hand of God, the fiery indignation of God, if you neglect so great a salvation? If you neglect these truths that you know to be true? And this isn't anything new. It's been spoken since the beginning. And it's been confirmed to us by the mouth of Abraham, by the mouth of Isaac, by the mouth of Jacob, by the mouth of Moses, Joshua, Elijah, Daniel, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Peter, James, Paul, and the Lord Jesus himself. And God, in verse 4, who bears them witness that the things that they said are true, that they're a witness of his character and his desire for mankind, He has shown that these things are true through signs and wonders, through miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. And so, friends, I want to press upon you this morning the weight, the burden that comes with the responsibility of being a follower of the Lord Jesus. This isn't anything that we should take lightly. Yes, Jesus came to give us life and life more abundantly. But Jesus was at war against his flesh from the moment he was born till the moment he died. And so should we be as his followers. There was a time in my life where I gave myself to video games, to computer games. And I put those things away quite some time ago as a sacrifice unto the Lord. Because, friends, I've got to tell you, my flesh, I love those games. And I was laying in bed last night and I felt the desire as my mind wandered as I was about to go to sleep. And I began to think about those games and I could feel my flesh craving those games with the same craving that a heroin addict has for heroin. And yet I had to nail my flesh to the cross and say, no, I will not give myself to those things. If for any other reason, as a sacrifice unto my Lord. And that's what we have to do with each and everything in our lives, friends. And so let me leave you with this thought this morning. You can never give up too much for the Lord and take a chance upon missing his blessing for doing so. But there are many blessings that you may be missing in your life because you haven't given up enough for the Lord. I hope that that resonates with you, friends. I hope that makes you stop and consider. I hope that makes you examine your life very carefully and ask yourself the question, is this thing that I'm holding on to? Is this thing that I enjoy? Could I not give it up for the cause of the Lord, for the sake of the Lord? And what blessing would be imparted to me by him for such sacrifice in my Christian duty? Well, I love you, friends. I'm grateful that you were again with us here this morning. I pray that the word of life is changing you from the inside out and that you are becoming a more disciplined follower of the Lord Jesus and learning the importance of sacrificing your flesh, of beating your body into subjection, of giving yourself unto the Lord and denying the things of this world, that you are learning the importance of these Christian practices and that your life is radiating with the beauty of the majesty on high because you have done so. Now, as he wills, and until next time, friends, I truly love you, and I'll see you on the next video.